started. I knew that was going to happen. And it's a good thing it does happen. Because okay, you may have to turn it up or down, but I don't know what. But anyhow, it's an honor to be here tonight, and I appreciate the McGuire's so very much. I really mean that with all my heart. And I'm so glad that you have taken the time to honor them and those that work with them as you have tonight.
Hallelujah.
That's great.
Amen.
I have a double honor tonight. 61 years ago, right about this time, my wife and I were exchanging vows.
Wow.
61 years ago. Thank you. Somebody asked me about it, and I said, well, we got married on Monday night because we didn't want to spoil anybody's weekend. And so we got married on Monday night. It was, that was our own choice and what we wanted to do. So we did. And 2 days later, got caught in a snowstorm. I hope it doesn't snow Tuesday. But anyway, it was such a snowstorm that I came around the turn up the outside of Hartland. I came around the turn, and I didn't realize it, but the road, snow had drifted across, and my car rolled up on the snow, and there we were. So we spent the night in a farmhouse. And the next morning, they hauled me back through the drift, and I went around by Bristol and went home that way to Juniper. Praise God. Well, I've got a message tonight. I'm giving you some of the good word of the Lord. I'm going to give you some experiences, some things that have happened in my life and in the life of the church over a number of years. And so please be patient, and I'll try and stay within reason. But I'm going to the second chapter of the book of Acts. Said, we've heard that preacher. I know you have, but that's what the Lord told me to do. And so that's exactly what I am going to do tonight. Praise God. Acts chapter number 2, verse number 1. And when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. And suddenly there came a sound from heaven, as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled all the house where they were sitting. And there appeared unto them cloven tongues like as of fire, and set upon each of them. But if you have, God wants to refill you tonight with the power of the Holy Ghost. Praise God. With the power of the Holy Ghost. Praise God. Hallelujah. You see, 52 years ago, I came to pastor this church. 52 years ago in July, I came as pastor. And I remember various things. And memory is a great thing. But I want to talk to you from the word of the Lord for a little bit before I begin to have to explain and tell you some of the things that have happened until he has first had his infilling of the Holy Ghost. Now that's our deposit. I don't read that in the book, but I believe it tonight with all of my heart. Praise God. And another thing tonight, I'm here to tell you that if you are not a tongue talker, and you are not talking in tongues real often, and by real often I'm talking about at least once a day, you need to have an infilling of the power of the Holy Ghost.
The former treaties have I laid off the office of all that Jesus began both to do and teach until the day in which he was taken up. After that, he through the Holy Ghost had given commandments unto the apostles to whom he had chosen. And listen to what verse 4 says. And being assembled together with them, commanded them that they should not depart from Jerusalem, but wait for the promise of the Father, which saith he, ye have heard of me.
Yeah.
And then he said, for John truly baptized with water, but he said he baptized them because they had repented. Mm-hmm. All right? But there's one coming, and he shall baptize you with the Holy Ghost, not many days hence. Praise God. Oh, hallelujah. I'm so glad for that tonight.
Thank you, Jesus.
I want to go back to the second chapter of the book of Acts. This past spring, I was just not quite 10 years of age. My birthday wasn't until June, and this was in the early part of the springtime. I went to school on a Tuesday morning.
Oh, God.
And there was a fellow there by the name of Stanley Prosser.
Uh-huh.
At recess time, he told me that he got the Holy Ghost. Uh-huh. The night before. Now, back then, we used to have what they call carry services. Anybody ever hear tell of that?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. I see a few hands waving. They remember that. I don't know to this day how come my mom and dad missed that first night. But I remember saying in my spirit, I'm getting the Holy Ghost tonight. I went to that carry service, Sister McGuire. I got down on my knees. My dad, I was kneeling right here, and I was kneeling right there, and there was the front door going out, and Mary and Lewis was kneeling over behind me, and some more folk were there, and they were praying and seeking God.
Oh, Jesus.
And I began to seek the Lord. I wasn't quite 10 years of age, and God began to move upon my spirit, upon my soul, and God filled me with the baptism of the Holy Ghost, and that has been 70 years ago. Praise God. Praise God. I belong to be baptized in the name of Jesus in South Branch of the Mamaroneck River, and the ice was still flowing.
Yeah.
But I'm glad that I was buried. In the name of Jesus Christ, 70 years ago. I remember, and I can't tell you the date of this, but I remember sometime in the late 50s, we had a young fellow by the name gone from me as quick as that. I was going to tell you his name, Lewis Stone. And Lewis made up his mind that he was going to get the Holy Ghost at 12 o'clock midnight.
Yeah.
Now why he purposed 12 o'clock midnight, I don't know. Most Pentecostals would be home and in bed by this time of the night.
But
12 o'clock. And so we stay. And we worship. And we praise God. My wife was scared to death. She thought the rapture took place and I left her. Didn't know where in the world we were. But as true as I'm here, he stood with his hands on the wall looking toward an elder brother Lewis, not Brother Harry Lewis. And that night at 12 o'clock, God filled him with the baptism of the Holy Ghost. Now you don't have to wait for 12 o'clock midnight.
No, sir.
You can get the Holy Ghost right now.
Yes. Yeah.
Hallelujah. It's 4:08. But you can have the Holy Ghost. You can have it.
Yeah.
You can have it. Praise the Lord.
Thank you, Holy Ghost.
I remember when I came to Harvey Station 52 years ago.
Oh, God.
I remember the old church we were in. so on. I was there in that church. I was praying, God, we need an outpouring of the Holy Ghost. We need the power of God. We need it. You know what, Sister McGuire? The Lord spoke to my heart. And the Lord said, you preach it and I'll do it. Hallelujah. I began to preach about the infilling of the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. You may have remembered that I began to preach about the baptism of the Holy Ghost. And it was on a Sunday night. And we were gathered around the altars. And I didn't know this until just last night. But anyway, there were four young girls. Two of them were out, Janice and Winona. The third one was Karen Cole. And the fourth one was Darlene Cole. I understand, I didn't know, but Winona told me last night that Karen had knelt down to pray. And somebody said to Karen, you better get up and stand with the rest of them around the altar. And they were there praying and seeking God. And all of a sudden, folks, as true as I'm here, I can't tell you which one of those four girls began to speak with other tongues and the Spirit of God gave them. Wouldn't have been seven until the 4th of June. And this was the 26th day of April. And God filled them with the Holy Ghost. My wife and I was a little bit leery, someone like Delton Thomas. We wondered if she really got the Holy Ghost. We're not going to tell her that she didn't. We'll just keep our ear tuned and listen. And sure enough, she was filled with the Holy Ghost along with the rest. Praise God. Some of you remember Granny Hope, Granny McCutcheon. No, not Granny McCutcheon. Granny Hope, thank you, Mom. Granny Hope. And her daughters, there were three of them that came to the church here. And they were concerned about Mama. They thought she was not going to get the